So I think it's recording. Hello everyone. My name is Suraj Jaiswal and welcome to the fifth tutorial of the course entitled Simulation of a Mechatronic Machine. In today's tutorial, we will be modeling a flexible lift boom mechanism. So as you can see on the animation, this is just to give you a brief idea about how the lift boom mechanism works. But this is not what we will be modeling, but an equivalent system of that. So before moving on to the system that we want to model, so these are the list of contents that I will be covering. First, I will brief you about the requirements in the introduction section. And then as per a normal drill, we'll go ahead and we'll model the number of bodies, joints, and input motion to the system. And at the end, I will show you how we can model the flexible lift boom model. So this is the system that we want to model. So this is the lift boom mechanism, where this body one, which is in red, is the lift boom. So we want to model it, this first body, as a flexible body. But at the moment, we will model it as a rigid body, so that once the entire system is working in terms of rigid bodies, then we'll go ahead and simply replace this first body with a flexible body. So if we see the requirements, what are the requirements for our system? So obviously we need a ground, we need a inertial reference system or global reference system placed on the ground, based on which all the bodies or joints will be modeled. Then we need gravity. So these are the three basic requirements for basically all the models. Then we need six bodies here and one optional body. So this base plate is kind of an optional body, because that helps you to visualize the system better. So it's suggested to model that. Then we need eight number of joints. So as you can see, this joint 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and then again there is joint 8, which is between body 6 and body 2, and one motion input, which will be provided to joint 7. And also body 5 and 6 are cylinder and piston. So you know now the requirements of our lift boom mechanism. So let's go ahead and model it as we can see it on the schematic figure. So first we'll model the number of bodies, then the joints, then we'll make the connection, and then we'll give the input motion. So let's go ahead with our modeling process. So I will go and open my MATLAB. I have MATLAB 2019A version. It will take a while to open my MATLAB. So once my MATLAB is opened, try to navigate to the folder where you want to save your model. So I want to save it in this folder. So the same path is over here. So in the command window, type smnew. Smnew will basically open a Simscape multibody new file for you, and once the file will be opened, it will by default have all the basic components there, or a predefined component. Again, it's taking a while to open this part, because I'm working on my server, so maybe that's the reason. So by default, these components are there. So before doing anything, let's go ahead and save our model as you want it to be. Save in the same folder where you navigated in the last MATLAB window. Once you have saved that model, let's go ahead with the modeling process. So by default, there is solver configuration and there is world frame. So this world frame already takes care of the ground and the inertial reference system. We just need to think about where we want to place the inertial reference system in our model. and we have mechanism configuration. So we need to define gravity. By default in this software, the gravity is in the negative z direction. But for us, we want the gravity to be in the negative y direction, because for us, if this is x, this is y, and z is coming out of the plane for all of us, then we want the gravity to act in the negative y direction, so vertically downward. So let's change that value. So I change the gravity from negative z to negative y direction, press enter, and okay. So I have done that. Then let's remove these portions so that you don't get confused, and we have enough space. So let's go ahead and remove it further. So let's go ahead and make our first base plate, which is optional but recommended. So let's rename it the solid component as the base plate. We double click this. The shape will be a brick, and the length will be, the dimensions will be, length is 850 millimeter, so 0.85. Breadth is 100 millimeter, and the height is 200 millimeter. And we press enter and F5. Okay. Then you don't need to worry about the inertia property, because this base plate will be rigidly connected to a ground, or it will basically represent ground. Also, the graphics, keep it as it is because we want it to be gray in color. In the frame, so observe carefully that this body already have a frame R in the center of this body. We don't need that one. Okay, just see carefully that this will be oriented like this in our main system, because we have X and Y in the plane of your screen, and Z is coming out of the screen. So like this. So the orientation of this body will be, it will be oriented something like this, correct? We want a frame on this edge in the middle, so that we can place our origin at in the middle of this edge, and then we can define our system. So let's go ahead, go to new frame. Let's say this name, the name of this frame to be origin based on geometric feature. Select this edge, then press use selected feature. So midpoint of plus X plus Y curve. This is what we want. This is what we want our frame to be located at. And then you press save. So by default, this R, we won't be using it. We have defined this origin here. If you try to orient this part, just be careful that you don't get confused because of this orientation, because it will be oriented like this in our actual system. So once you have done that, press OK. Then select this block, use Control R to orient, to change the orientation of this block so that origin is located on the right face. Okay. Once you have that, let's call for solid component block again, and we'll rename it as body one, and it is rigid at the moment. Okay, double click this. Now so this part you need to understand very carefully, that normally when we have the length, breadth and height, we give it in the same order as X, Y, and Z. If you go to this presentation, where is it? If you follow the presentation here, you see the length is 100 millimeter, breadth is 50 millimeter, and height is 30 millimeter. But instead of putting it in this order, we have just changed the order such that the length is along the Z axis. Why are we doing this? Is because of two reasons. First, sometimes you might end up giving the order of the dimensions incorrectly. So in that way, using this tutorial, you can know, okay, how you can fix that. And the second part is, we are defining the orientation of the dimension to be like this, like this modified version, because when we will be defining the flexible body, the flexible body is defined in such a way by default that its length is along the z-axis. So for that reason, we are orienting, or we are defining our geometry in such a way so that, like at later point of this video, we can simply remove the rigid body one part and replace it with the flexible part, with the flexible body, right? So let's go ahead and define our dimensions such that breadth is along x, height is along y, and the length is along z-axis, okay? So let's go back to the modeling. Okay, this is... So now the dimensions will be 0.05, 0.03, and the length is 1 along z-axis. Press enter and then F5. So your body is updated. Now in the inertia, we want it calculated from geometry based on density. Density can be that of steel, which is 7,800 kilogram per meter cube. And the derived values, you need to update this. Then in the graphics, I want it to be red in color. So it's red, green, and blue. Let's increase the red part. Press enter and then F5. Your body is updated. Now we need frames on two ends of this body. So one on this end, one on the other end. We don't need this frame at the center of this body. So we can turn this off and then press F5. Because whenever you make any changes, you need to update the visualization window. Then you need to go to, in order to define the frames, you need to go to new frame. Let's say this is L, so a frame on the left side, because that will be easy. You can name it as you want. I'm giving it as L. So based on geometric feature, I'll select the surface at the bottom. So this surface, and then use selected feature. So centroid of minus Z surface, okay? And I press save. Then I go ahead and model another frame, which I call it R, which is based on geometric feature. And I select the top surface, this one, and use selected feature. So centroid of plus Z surface. And I save it. So I have these two frames L and R defined, and my body one is ready. So I press okay. Okay. Let's shape this a little bit. Not really so much important here, but it's up to you. So once we have done that, let's go back to our presentation slide and define the other bodies. So basically body 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. You can pause the video and see the details from the slide, or you can just follow the presentation as well. So type solid component block. Let's rename it as body 2. If you double click this, my body 2 is also brick in shape. The dimensions are okay. Now we will define the dimensions as it should be for all the remaining bodies. So just for body 1, it was a special case, because later we want to replace it with a flexible body. So the length is 250 millimeter, breadth is 30 millimeter, and height is 20 millimeter. Okay, and we press enter and then F5. Okay, now height is 20 millimeter, not 200 millimeter. Press enter F5. So this is our body in the inertia based on geometry, based on density, and that of steel, 7,800 kilogram per meter cube. Enter F5. Then update the derived values. The graphics, I want it to be green in color. So I'll increase the red, green, blue, the green value. Enter F5. So now my body is like this. And if you see carefully, this body will be oriented such a way that in the actual system, overall mechanism, it will be oriented like this, right? So X, Y, and Z is coming out of the plane. So we need two frames on both ends of this body. So the left and the right, correct? We don't need the center frame R, so we can turn it off. F5. So let's go to new frame. Let's say this is L based on geometric feature. Then select the minus centroid of minus X surface, use selected feature, and then save. Similarly, new frame on the right, I call it R based on geometric feature. Select the surface, use selected feature, so centroid of plus X surface, and then save it. So you have your body 2 ready as well. If you try to use the isometric view, don't get confused with how it is oriented. You just need to be very careful about this X, Y, and Z over here, right? And then you need to press OK. So once you press OK, let me cross check. OK, so our body 2 is ready. Body 3 is have almost the same dimension and properties as body 2. So we can simply copy body 2 and we say it as body 3. Okay, before that, body 1 is rigid body, right? So I have just renamed it. You don't need to make the connections yet. So body 3 just has a different length, which is 200 millimeter. Press enter F5. All the other properties can be same because you have just copied it from body 2. Just you need to update the visualization. So I want it to be blue in color. So I'll increase the red, green, blue value. Enter F5. And these frames will be adjusted automatically because the moment you change the dimensions. So you don't have to worry about that. You just need to press OK. So our body 2 is ready as well. Now we need to make body 4, which is a mass on this end of body. So again, we use the solid component block. We will say it is body 4. If you double click this, so the dimensions are 200 millimeter all sides, so 0.20. Press enter, then F5. So my body is updated. Inertia properties will be based on geometry. Density. Density can be that of steel, 7,800 kilogram per meter cube. Enter F5. And then derived values, you can just update it using that update option. In the graphics, I want this to be pink in color. So let's say I don't know the color code for pink. I can use it. I can select this option and then I can simply select my color as pink. And I press OK. So now when I press F5, my color is updated. Correct? Now I need to define a frame. So by default, there's a frame R at the center. We will be using that frame. And if you see this carefully, this body will be oriented like this in our main system. So X, Y, and Z is coming out of the plane, right? Let's see, where is frame R? There is frame R. So we need to define a frame on this surface in the middle. So what we can do, we can go to new frame. Let's say we call it frame L. Based on geometric feature, select this surface, use selected feature. So centroid of minus X surface and press save. So once you do that, press OK. So my body 4 is ready as well. That's good. Now I have body 2 ready, body 3 ready. Now I need body 5 and 6, correct? So again, I search for solid component block. I will say it as body 5, which is a cylinder. If I double click this, I want the shape to be cylinder. Radius will be 30 millimeter, so 0.03, 30 millimeter. Length will be 400 millimeter, so 0.40. Okay, so 30 millimeter is the radius, 400 millimeter is the length. Okay, if we press enter, F5, my block visualization is updated. Inertia will be again based on geometry density, that of steel, 7800 kilograms per meter cube. Press enter, F5, update this derived values. Graphics, I want it to be cyan in color. So for example, let's go to this, select the cyan color and press OK. And now if you press F5, the color is updated. Correct. Okay. Now we need frames on two ends of the cylinder. So we don't need the center frame. So this center frame R, we don't need it. We can turn this off. Press F5. Then we need to go to new frame. Let's say this is L. Based on geometric feature, select the bottom surface. Use selected feature, center of bottom surface. Press save. Then again, new frame. Say R. Based on geometric feature, use the top surface. Use selected feature, center of top surface. And press save. Now observe very carefully that when we define a cylindrical body, it is such that the length is along the z-axis. So similarly, in a similar way that we defined body 1. So just keep that in mind, because later we will be using rigid transform to reorient this. Or you can reorient this the frames using this primary and secondary axis as well. We will not be doing that. We will be using rigid transform so that you know how to use rigid transform and what is the essence of having the coordinate transformation. So now press OK. You can simply copy paste this block to model our sixth body, which is a piston. Let's rename it. Don't make these connections yet. So dimensions of the pistons are a little different. So now the radius is 20 millimeter and the length is 550 millimeter. Press enter, F5. So the frames will be automatically taken care of. We just need to update the graphics. So I want it to be yellow in color. So I go to this option, select the yellow color, press F5. So now I have my piston as well, which is yellow in color, and the frames on two ends. Press OK. Perfect. Let's go back to our slides. So we have by default had all the basic components, so which is ground, inertial reference system, and gravity. We defined the bodies as well. What we need to do next is we define the joints. So before modeling the joint, you need to think carefully what kind of joint should be suitable for the system so that you don't over constrain the system, right? So if you go back to the figure, so you know there's a cylinder and a piston, 45 and 6. So this joint 7 will be a prismatic joint. Perfect. Whereas this joint 5, which is between body 1 and 4, will be a fixed joint because there is no movement between these two bodies. Whereas the remaining joint, which is joint 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, and 8, at first you can say, okay, all of them can be revolute joint. It's fine if you model that way, revolute joint. There's no problem with it. You can just go ahead and model joint 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, and 8 as revolute joint. But from my experience and also from what I have taught already in the second tutorial, you can find the video from my YouTube channel. So in the second tutorial, I actually showed you that this joint 3 and joint 8, if you model it using revolute joint, it will include redundant constraints. In order to get rid of the redundant constraints, you can simply replace this joint 3 and joint 8 by using bearing joints. So that's what we are gonna do. We are gonna need 4 revolute joint for joint 1, joint 2, joint 4, and joint 6. 1 prismatic joint for joint 7. 1 weld joint, which acts as a rigid joint for joint 5. And 2 bearing joints for joint 3 and joint 8. Okay, so if you want to follow the reference, follow this tutorial 2 about crankshaft modeling from my YouTube channel. But let's go ahead. So we will be needing 1 weld joint, 4 revolute joint, 2 bearing joint, and 1 prismatic joint. Whereas there is 1 extra weld joint, which is optional. So let me go back to the model and show you. So if you want to connect this base plate with the origin, with the world frame, you can do that using simply dragging and connecting it to the world frame. What it will do, first of all, it will create the origin to be the frame origin, named origin of the base plate. So on the middle of the right edge of the base plate, okay, right top edge. If you run the system like this using this simple connection, it might solve the purpose, but many times the solver might end up giving you some warning or some error. So it's always good to use a weld joint. You can use the default value between this connection so that you can be sure there will be no error from the solver. So this can be a weld joint. So this is an optional weld joint that I was talking about. So let's go ahead and model our first joint, which is revolute joint between the base plate or the ground and body 1. So let's rename it as joint 1. Okay, and this needs to be connected to body 1. So in joint 1, we want body 1 to be at 0 degree angle. So for that, we need to define the state target, position level state target, and we want the priority to be high, so value to be 0. So and we press OK. So we have a state target here. Perfect. The other values can be default values, so that's fine. Now observe body 1 very carefully. So by default, revolute joint rotates about the z-axis. So this is, if this is x, y, and z is coming out of the plane, it will revolve like this. But the body 1, which is a rigid body, the length is along the z-axis. So we need to transform that length so that instead of the length being in z-axis, it becomes it in x-axis, correct? How we can do that? By using rigid transform. If you want to follow the detail of this transformation, try to follow the other tutorials, specifically tutorial 2 about crankshaft modeling. But let's go ahead and I'll try to explain the same thing here as well in this video. So we search for rigid transform block. Let's say it's associated to body 1. I'm renaming it, and it's the first one. So rigid transform. Okay. So I will connect it in such a way that the base plate is connected to the base frame of the rigid transform is connected to joint 1, and the follower frame is connected to body 1. So if we double click this, before going into that, okay, if you open the body 1, so see, the X, Y, and Z is oriented like this, but the body will be oriented something like maybe this or maybe like this in our actual system, right? Okay. Correct. So this is left and right, and this is center R. Okay, let me take a screenshot and explain you what I'm trying to explain. So let me take a screenshot. Okay. But so this is the orientation of the body in its local reference frame. But we want, in the global reference frame, our X is like this, Y is like this. So this is X, Y, and this is Z is coming out of the plane like this, correct? So we need the rigid transform such that, let's close this window, such that in this rigid transform, if we go, we need to define it using method aligned axis. You can try other methods as well. Such that since the follower frame is connected to the body, so the follower frame, if it's in the Z axis, then the base frame needs to be in the X axis. So this X, this Z axis, this over here, needs to be on the X axis, correct? And then the Y axis needs to be on the Z axis, or the X axis of the follower needs to be on the Y axis of the base frame, right? So you can define either of the two as the second pair, but for first pair, you need to define the Z axis of the follower frame to be on the X axis of the base frame. So Z axis of the follower is on the X axis of the base frame. And then I'm defining the other pair as Y axis of the follower needs to be on the Z axis of the base frame. So once I define this, it would be fine. And then I press OK. Yes. Similarly, the other end of this body also needs the same rigid transform, since the other end of the body will be connected to the other parts of the system. So we can simply copy this, and we can say this as the second rigid transform associated to body 1. We can simply rotate it using Control R so that the follower frame is still connected to body 1 and the base frame will be connected to the other parts of the system. Don't make the connections yet. So now if we go ahead and simply let's say make the connection, for example, my joint 1 is connecting the base plate and body 1 using the rigid transform. And if I'm not connecting the second rigid transform associated to body 1 yet, because that will be needed once I connect body 4 with the body 1. So let's go and simulate the system and see if we are right on the track or not. So in order to view the simulation, you need to go to Y up XY front, and then you need to press front viewer. So yes, something is definitely happening. So if I see that time t equals to 0, so my body 1 is horizontal as I wanted it to be. And if I press it, if I have defined everything correctly, I mean, in terms of if my rigid transforms are correct, then it should simply oscillate as a pendulum about this point. And that's what it is doing at the moment. Correct? And that's what I was expecting. So we are on the right track in terms of using the rigid transform. So let's go ahead and model the other joints. So for joint 2, I need again a revolute joint, such that the revolute joint is oriented so that the base frame will be connected to body 1. So let's use Control R to orient this. Then this is joint 2, which is a revolute joint. And okay, just observe very carefully that joint 2 is a revolute joint connecting body 1 and 2. But where is that connection? If you see the presentation, so this is body 2, the green one, and the red one is body 1. So this joint is at a distance, which is this 1.5 into 1 by 8 meter apart from the origin. So how we can use that? We can use that using a rigid transform such that it is located at a distance. The joint is located at a distance of this unit from the origin along the z plus x direction. Okay. Why this is such a typical number? It's because when we were defining body 1 as a flexible body, this joint will be, we will define the flexibility as divided into 8 elements. And this joint will be located actually in the middle of the second element. So for that reason, it is 1.5 into 1 by 8 meter. So let's go back to our model and use another rigid transform. So let's search for rigid transform. It is associated to joint 2. So I'm renaming it accordingly. Orient it such a way that the base frame is connected to body 1. So Control R. Okay. Perfect. So now if we double click this rigid transform, we want the translational offset using Cartesian method, and the offset will be, you can simply type the formula here or the exact number. So 1.5 into 1 by 8 meter it was. And I press OK. So now I can simply go ahead and make the connection of this rigid transform with body 1. So obviously it is not connected to body 1 directly, but using the rigid transform block. So it is connected to body 1 via the rigid transform block for body 1. Okay, then make this connection accordingly. Okay, then body 2 and 3 are connected via a bearing joint. So search for bearing joint. Let's say it is joint 3. You can use the default properties. You can simply go ahead and make the connections. Then body 3 needs to be connected to the base plate using a revolute joint. But if you see this presentation, body 3, this blue body is connected to the base plate using a revolute joint here, but it is at a distance of 100 meter in the negative x direction from the origin. So similarly, the way we defined the rigid transform for body 2, for joint 2, in the same way we will define the rigid transform for joint 4. So let's go back to our presentation. First we will add this revolute joint. So this revolute joint is associated. This is basically joint 4. Perfect. Once we have this joint, then we need a rigid transform. Search for rigid transform. It is associated to joint 4. Okay. I'm just making space for everything here. So try to orient this rigid transform such that the base frame is connected to the base plate. So Control R, and again joint 4 needs to be, block needs to be oriented such that the base frame is connected to the base frame is of the joint is connected to the follower frame of the rigid transform associated to joint 4. So once you have that in the rigid transform associated to joint 4, you need to go to translational using Cartesian method. Now it is at a distance of 100 millimeter, but in the negative x direction. So minus 0.10. That is 100 millimeter. Press OK. So now if we go ahead and make the connection, and by the way, joint 2, you connected it to body 1 directly. Actually, if you go ahead and make the connection to the this end of joint 1 or simply to the base plate, it's fine because we are defining the joints with respect to the base plate. So even though we have connected it over here, it's fine. You can connect it anywhere. So that's why we will connect this body joint 4 to the base plate using this rigid transform for joint 4. And let's go ahead and make the connections. So once we have this, let's go ahead and make our fifth joint, which is the joint connecting body 1 with body 4. So how we can do that? Let me make some space here actually. So I'm moving all the blocks to make some space. Okay, so we need a weld joint. So search for weld joint. That will be our joint 5. And it will be between body 1 and body 4 using the bit through the rigid transform of body 1. So simply go ahead and make the connection. It can be the default value. So now if we simulate our system, we are expecting the body 1, 2, 3 and the base plate to form a 4-bar mechanism as I showed you in the schematic drawing at the beginning. And then body 4 will be connected on the other end of body 1. So let's go ahead and simulate the system to see if everything. Okay, why is there error? Okay, I have not connected this rigid transform associated to the other end of body 1. So I have connected this and then I simulate the system. So now if I go to see the simulation, at time t equals to 0, this is how the system looks, and that's what we have. So this body 1, 2, 3 and base plate is forming a 4-bar mechanism, and then there is another body 4 hanging on the other end of body 1. And if you simulate, it should just make an oscillation, sort of a pendulum. And if you are able to get this kind of animation or this kind of behavior, it's fine. So that means that you have defined everything very accurately using all the rigid transforms and the joints, and things are fine. So let's go back to our modeling. So now we need to model the joints associated to body 5 and 6. So let's go back to our slides. So far we have modeled board this joint 5. We need to define joint 6, 7, and 8. So let's go back to the modeling. So joint 6 will be the joint between the base plate or the ground and body 5. And what kind of joint was needed? It was a revolute joint. So this is joint 6. It is a revolute joint. And if you see the presentation, this revolute joint, it is at an offset of 700 millimeter from the origin, and it is at an angle with respect to the base frame in the counterclockwise direction. So we will say the angle to be 15 degree because we are not very sure. So we'll say the priority to be low. So let the system figure out what will be the exact value. And let's go back to the model. So when you define this, we say the state target to be position state target, value to be 15 degree, priority to be low. Press OK. And then we need a rigid transform such that, so we search for rigid transform. Okay, orient this joint 6 such that the base is connected to the base frame of the joint is connected to the base plate. So control R. And similarly, this rigid transform associated to joint 6. Orient this in a similar way as you did it for joint 2 and 4. And this rigid transform will have an offset of 700 millimeter in the negative x direction using Cartesian method. So minus 0.70, that's 700 millimeter, right? In the negative x direction, so minus x from the origin. Okay. You can simply make the connection here. That would be fine. But now this joint needs to be connected to the cylinder. Now observe very carefully that if you open the body 5 cylinder, here also the length is along the Z axis. Similarly, what we had for body 1. So even in order to connect the joint 6 with the body 5, you need a rigid transform that will help to orient the frames of body 5. So specifically the frame L. Since body 1 was also oriented in a similar way as body 5, so it's safe if we can just use this body 1 rigid transform, the first one. So if we copy paste and say it's for body 5, and you can keep the value as it is, because if you observe carefully, body 1 and body 5 are oriented similarly, and for that reason we can use the same rigid transform to make the connections. So if we go ahead and so this end of body 5 is oriented properly using this rigid transform, and we can then make the connection with the joint 6. Okay, now there is, if you now go ahead and simulate the system, let's see if we have defined it accurately. Okay, so everything is oscillating, which is fine. So yes, body 5 we have defined accurately as it should be. So we are just missing with the piston, which is body 6, and then once we model it would be fine. So let's go back to our model. So there's a translational joint between body 5 and body 6, and if we follow the presentation, this translational joint is located inside the cylinder along its length, which is about z-axis. So if you go back to the presentation, it's okay if you search for a prismatic joint, then you can use the default value of the prismatic joint, just rename it as joint, I think it's joint 7, prismatic joint. By the way, since we will be providing a motion input to joint 7, so it's good to just make the port available. So in the actuation inside the prismatic joint, it's for the force, automatically computed motion provided by input. If we do that, it will by default open a port for a motion input. So let's do that already. So once we have it, we just need a rigid transform such that this joint 7 is located inside the body 5 along its length. So if we search for rigid transform, let's say rigid transform associated to joint 7. Be very careful with the naming. You can name it as it is. I try to follow naming such that it's easy for me. This rigid transform, the base frame will be connected, or the base frame of this rigid transform will be connected to body 5, and the follower frame will be connected to body 6. So accordingly, if we go to this rigid transform in the translation method, since body 5 and Z body 6 are along the length, it's along the Z axis lengthwise. So we need to go to the standard axis method. The axis is X, axis will be Z because that's how the lengths are defined for them. And if you follow my presentation, the offset is in the negative inside the cylinder, so minus, and it is 0.225 millimeters, so 0.225. Yes, and if we press OK, it would be fine. So simply go ahead and make the connections. Now again, the other end of piston, so the right end of piston, basically body 6 needs to be connected to body 2. So we need a rigid transform here to orient this frame R. So we can simply copy this one and rotate it such that the frame F is still connected to body 6 and the base frame will be connected to the other parts. So let's say it is associated to body 6. So this rigid transform is to orient the directions of such that the length is along Z axis, but we want the length to be along X axis. If we make this connection, and then we need a bearing joint to connect body 6 either with body 3 or body 2. We will connect it to body 2. So let's search for a bearing joint. Okay, it can be default value, and this joint 8, I think. Yes, this is joint 8. So now if we just go ahead and make the connections, so with body 2, so if we just go ahead and make the connections, so I'm just trying to orient it in a nice way. So if we go ahead and make the connection and see the simulation, let's go ahead and see our visualization. So this is how the system should look. Since we have defined everything very accurately and there is no input motion at the moment, so it will behave like this. So there will be no movement at all, which is fine. So now let's go back and define the provider input to the system. But before that, let's make some space. Sometimes it's difficult to make space. Yeah, I think that would be fine. So we will give the motion input using a sine wave. So you can search for sine wave block. In the sine wave block, we want the amplitude to be 0.01 meter and the frequency can be 10 radian per second. Press OK. So this sine wave needs to be connected to prismatic joint using a Simulink PS converter. So we have this Simulink PS converter. We can also use this one. So let's use the one we already have. So let's try the matters. It should be in the PS Simulink converter. You need to go to input handling, filter and derivatives, select it as filter input derivatives calculated. Filtering order needs to be second order and the time constant can be default, and press OK. All of these I have taught you already in the previous tutorial. That's why I'm not going into the detail, but in the input handling, second order means exactly for velocity and acceleration. So you can let the solver know about the derivatives of the input function. So let's go ahead and make the connections. So now if we try to simulate, okay, before simulating, we also need to plot the results. Let's say I'm very much interested to see how the system will behave. I want to observe the angle and the x and y position of body 4. So for that I need to use this PS Simulink converter. As well as I need a transform sensor to actually sense the parameters of transform sensor. Let's show the name. So transform sensor, then if you go to transform sensor, I want to sense the angle and I want to sense the x and the y position. So press OK. So in the transform sensor, the base frame needs to be connected to a reference frame, and what can be better than the origin? Correct. I hope there is enough space for everything. I think it's visible for you, right? Okay, and then the follower frame needs to be connected to the center frame of body 4. So I'm sensing exactly the center point of body 4. Then I need, so this converter, PS Simulink converter, can be for angle. For example, PS Simulink rename it as you like. And scope is for angle. Similarly, you can copy these two blocks to have the converter and scope for the x position. Can be position. And another converter for the y position. Correct. Let's make some space here. You can connect this position, y position converter, to the same position and put position scope. And then connect the ports from the transformer sensor to the respective converter. So the angle to the angle port, X position to the X position port, and Y position to the Y position port. So once you do that, it would be fine. And let's simulate the system for 2 seconds, let's say. So now if you, and also if you want to log this signal, you can just select this part, these signals, right click, and then log selected signal. Then later, once you run the simulation, you can follow the data inspector to log the data. So run the simulation. So now when we run the simulation, let's see how is the animation. So a motion input to this prismatic joint, a sine wave input will cause such an animation. If you see the isometric view, this is how it looks. Okay, let's go back to the front view. And also at time t equals to zero, I wanted the orientation to be like this, as shown on your screen. So things are fine as far as the visualization is concerned. But let's see the plots. If you see the angle by double clicking the scope, this is how the angle of body one, body four is behaving. And this is the X and Y position. So this is X and this is the Y position of the body four. So you can also see the plots. Now, you need to, one important thing that you need to have a look is, if you go to analysis, Simscape variable viewer, then you can see the different state targets that you defined in the system. So if you see this one, you see for Revolut Joint 6, we defined the angle to be 15 degree with low priority, but the actual angle is 13.5946, whatever. So the solver is kind of finding it out. And also if you see joint one, we set it the angle to be 0 degree, but the angle is not exactly 0 degree, but it is something like 0.0350 something degree and in the clockwise direction. That's why if you observe the animation here, it's slightly tilted in the vertical downward direction. But you can't observe it until you see these values. So this was about the variable viewer. If you go to analysis, Simscape, and statics viewer, now there are two things that I'm very much interested to see is, first, there are no redundant constraints. So if you see this position constraint equations, total is 4, non-redundant is 4. So there are no redundant constraints, which is good. And the degree of freedom of the system. So if you see the system, if we have not provided any input signal, then the degree of freedom should be 1. But since we have provided a motion input, so you remember, whenever we provide a motion input, that is like we are modeling it as a constraint into the system to move our mechanism. So for that, it takes off 1 degree of freedom off from the system. But this software does not, I don't know why, it does not sense that. So for that, you need whatever the number of mechanism degree of freedom will be, you need to just subtract that from the number of inputs you are giving. So we have 1 and then 1 input. So the degree of freedom of the mechanism is 0. And also there is no flexibility degree of freedoms, because there is no flexibility in the system in terms of no flexible body. So everything is as per our expectation. But now the most important part is, everything is now working as per the rigid body, but now we want this first body to be defined as a flexible body. So let's go back to our slide so that I know we are following the slides. So I have covered this part. I also covered this part. I also showed you how the system will look and how will it behave and how will be the responses. And now I am defining the flexible boom model. So creating the flexible equivalent of our system is very simple. We can just define a body using general flexible beam. So we will define a flexible boom, which is the first body. And then we can simply replace that with the rigid body that we have already defined. This flexibility is based on Euler, Bernoulli, and St. Venant theories. These are the other two theories that if you want to have a look at, you can go into the detail. But the flexible part is modeled using finite element method. So the way you're defining finite element method, similarly, you can define it over here. So let's go back to our model. So let's search for general flexible beam and rename it as body one. Okay, by default, it has two ports, two frames at the two ends of this body. If we double click this, okay. In the geometry part, let's understand this part. In the geometry part, if you go to the cross section, you can actually define the profile of the cross section. If you go to this portion, what you are defining is actually you are defining few points. So this is x1, y1, x2, y2, x3, y3, and x4, y4. Such that, let's go to back to the slide. Such that you are defining, so the origin as at the center of this profile, for example, and then you are defining your points in the anti-clockwise direction. So over here we are defining first x1, y1, so which will be, for example, since this is the breadth and this is kind of the height, so x1, y1 will be half of breadth and half of height. So 0.025 and 0.015 as x1, y1. And then accordingly, you can change the sign and the values accordingly. So let's go back to our model and let me show you how it is done. So if you go to this x1, y1, you can simply change it like this. Okay, so it was 0.05, 0.03, correct. I hope I'm defining it accurately. If not, we can cross-check it later, but so far it looks good to me. Okay, and then we press OK. Length will be 1 meter, as we know already from the rigid body block, and we need to press F5. So my body is updated. So this is how my body should look like, exactly the same way as it is there for the rigid body, for rigid block for body one. And the stiffness, the density will be that of steel, so 7800 kilogram per meter cube. Young's modulus will be 210. And Poisson's ratio will be 0.30, and damping constant can be 1 millisecond. Press F5. These parameters you can find it from my slides. Then in the derived values you can update this. Then I want the color to be okay. Before that, discretization. So how many number of elements? As I already gave you a sneak peek in the middle of my presentation, there needs to be 8 elements. So the entire body is divided into 8 elements. And then I want the graphics to be red in color. So RGB, R is 0.9. Press enter, F5. Now my body is updated. As I told you, there will be on the two ends of the body, there will be two frames by default. And notice very carefully the orientation of this body. So over here also the orientation is such a way that the length is along the z-axis. So exactly the same way how we had this rigid body for body ones. You see this part? And then you see this part. So the orientations are same. So it's good. We can just replace this body one rigid body block by this flexible block and things will be fine. And that was the reason for us to defining the rigid body in this orientation. So let's go ahead and press OK. And then remove these connections from the rigid body and place it with the flexible body. So once we do that, we would like to simulate the model. If we go ahead and simulate the model for 2 seconds, you will realize that it's taking a lot of time for simulating. Why is that happening? Now you need to think very carefully. Just try to visualize the points that why is it behaving like this? There are a number of reasons. The first reason is obviously you have defined such a high flexibility into your system, correct? So, and you have defined the boom to be divided into 8 elements. So obviously that is kind of increasing the computational cost of the system. And the second point is maybe your consistency tolerance for the solver is too high. So either you can change the number of discretization elements in your flexible part, or you can change the consistency tolerance. So let me pause this because still now it hasn't solved even for like 1 second. So let's go ahead, go back to our model. Stop the simulation. Go to solver configuration. Change the consistency tolerance to be 10 to the power 3. Unit. Press OK. And now when you simulate the system again, now you see it's much faster. So it's kind of the simulation is kind of, the solver is able to simulate. So you can play around with the number of elements, with the solver settings, and see what result you are getting for your mechanism. But let's wait so that we can see and compare the results. So things are looking fine as per the visualization is concerned, but we can't really see the flexibility from the visualization much. Maybe the flexibility is not that loud, but do not worry about it. Till the time our visualization is working fine, we can always have plots to see how the system is behaving. So till the time system is simulating, let's go back to our model and see the analysis part. We can't see the analysis part till the system has solved. So we will have to wait. So once it's done, first we will see how's the plot. Then we will see how is the statics viewer and what things have changed if we replace the rigid boom with a flexible boom. And then we'll compare the result of the flexible boom mechanism with the rigid boom mechanism. It's almost done. So almost there. Fine. So it's simulated. So if we see the animation, this is how the system is behaving. If you observe very carefully, maybe you can sense some sort of flexibility there. Let's see the isometric view. Not so much, to be honest. So let's go, and also at time t equals to 0, things are as it should be. So let's go back to our model and see the plots. So if we see the angle plot, this is how it is behaving. It's kind of a little different from the rigid body equivalent of the system. And also the position, the nature is the same, but with a little variation. But we'll compare it. But before that, we go to analysis, Simscape, statics viewer. Because whenever you do any change, it's always good to see this part every time you make a change. So first of all, the number of redundant constraints are zero again. Whereas now the mechanism degree of freedom is 49. Actually, it's 49 minus one for the motion input. So 48. So you see 48 degrees of freedom. And why there are 48 degrees of freedom? It's because of this flexible body. So we have divided the flexible body into eight elements. Each element, it's in three dimension, so it has 6 degrees of freedom. So 6 into 8 is 48 degrees of freedom. So everything is as we have it in theory or as per our expectation. So we have modeled our system very accurately, but I'm very interested to see how is the result compared to the system where there was just a rigid body and no flexible body. If we see the angle plot compared with the angle plot of the rigid body, you see, so for the rigid body, this blue plot was there, but for the flexible body, the angle has changed. So clearly, the flexibility has been introduced. And also, if we see the Y position, if we compare the Y position, we can see a significant difference of this flexible part with the rigid equivalent part, correct? So you can compare the results and you can even save these results as you want. So this is what we can analyze from the system, and also things are as per the expectation, as per theory. So we have modeled everything very accurately. So let's go back to the slide and see if I have anything or not. So I already introduced, showed you how we can model the flexible boom into the system. And I also showed you how the system will look and how it will behave. So over here you can see a number of reference frames and center of mass. So if you want to do that, you can simply go to this option, use this toggle visibility of frames and center of mass, and you can have the same thing. So that's not a problem. So I have covered this part as well for the flexible rigid lift boom mechanism. And then I also showed you the comparison between flexible and rigid part. So that's all from my end for this week's tutorial. If you have any question, you can comment it in this video, or you can simply email me. But if you like this video, thank you so much. Try to follow the other tutorials as well, and you can get an explanation of all your queries, all the modeling process in the other videos as well. But till now, thank you so much and have a good day ahead.